Okay, so we should get started. So one of the benefits of organizing this seminar is to, I get to invite people I know and I worked with in the past, right? So today we have Aleksandra Sarcevic from Drexel. And I know Aleksandra for many years. In fact, in conferences, we always presented the same session. We both studied in the hospital settings, and I read almost every single paper of hers.
And vice versa.
Yeah. So today, my understanding is she's going to talk about a new project that they're designing an interactive checklist that is going to be used at a hospital environment. This talk is going to be slightly different from a lot of talk we had in the past. And the environment setting is going to be a life critical environment, safety critical, life time critical environment. And every single small changes made in that environment may lead to errors or issues, and patient may die. So it's a very, very safe critical environment. So Alex has been studying in that environment for many years. I think the first time I heard about her talk, she's doing the trauma resuscitation, and she's reviewing the videos from the trauma teams. And I heard that, I'm not sure whether that's true, I heard from someone else that you have to review the video, analyzing the video within like 48 hours or something.
That was the case, yep.
Yeah, so this will give you a different perspective of running studies in the hospital environment or maybe similar life-critical environment. So a little bit background about Alex. She's now assistant professor at Drexel, and I actually graduated there, so we have a lot of things in common. And her work has been published in CHI, CSW, and health informatics journals and conferences. I just wanted to point it out that her work has been funded by NSF. She actually got a Career Award, and also she got quite a few NIH awards. So that's actually amazing that her work is being supported by the health sciences fundings. So today she's going to present this new work, which I know a little bit, but I'm also open to learn from you today about your new project.
Thank you so much, Yunnan. Thanks really for getting me here. It's been really something on my list for a long time. The closest I was to Irvine was in 2015 when the iConference was here, and I didn't have a chance to actually visit the campus. I know there was like a tour, but I couldn't stay that extra day, and I've been really, I know so many of you from the conferences, and we go to the same venue, so it's been really great to finally come and see your beautiful campus and meet with people. So it's great to be here, and I'm really excited about sharing the work we've been doing in my lab and generally as a part of a bigger team in the safety critical setting, as Yunnan explained. So today I was really planning to focus on the checklist project, but maybe before that, just to set the stage for the talk and to get us all on the same page, I would just like maybe share a couple of definitions and concepts and talk a little bit broader about the research program so that you get that contextual knowledge around it. So just starting with the medical informatics, and it's interesting that Yunnan said health informatics, right? And there's like an interchangeable use of the terms. And this is the definition I came to like because it really brings the cognitive, the information, and the communication aspects in the field together that are so important to us who study in HCI and CCW area. So this is the field concerned with the cognitive information processing and communication tasks of medical practice, education, and research, including the information science and the technology to support these tasks. So the research I've been doing is really at the cross-section of information science and communication and information technology design as applied to the medical practice. But even narrowing it more down, I've been really focusing on emergency medicine, and these are just a couple of pictures from the settings that you would normally see in an emergency critical care setting where medical specialty, right, that's really focusing on acute injuries, either adult or pediatric, depending on the environment in which you are, that really require immediate medical attention. And so when I started early working in this area, and it's been actually already a decade, as part of my PhD work in 2006, early as I was getting involved in this area, I was trying to think about, okay, what are some of these conceptual, intellectual connections between the areas that now I consider are actually my home fields, like human-computer interaction and CSCW, right? So these are the areas where I was really interested and wanted to contribute as my communities and primary communities, but then really focused on the medical informatics literature and the rich body of work that looks into how these communication, information, cognition intersect in the medical practice with the focus that I have on particular domain of emergency medicine. And what I came to realize really is that this is an ideal environment, almost like a live laboratory, to study a lot of the concepts that we in HCI or CCW really care about, like awareness and coordination and efficiency in communication, and with the goal of reducing errors, improving patient outcomes. So it has that medical component, but it's really centered around information technology, and it allows you to really experiment at the same time with different interventions and designs while doing something for a better, higher good. So that's really kind of like to just set the stage for the domain. So the trauma resuscitation, as Yunan pointed out, it is this process of treating acute injuries, and I happen to really focus on pediatric trauma, but I've done a lot of research in adult centers as well, where you have a critically injured patient arriving to the hospital, where a team of nurses, doctors, physicians, surgeons gathers around and really tries in a very short amount of time to stabilize the patient, identify all the life-threatening injuries, and you can think about worst-case scenarios, like gunshot wounds and traffic accidents, stab wounds, and really critically acute injuries, to stabilize the patient and then develop the patient hospitalization plan. So these are specialized rooms within the emergency department. The teams are also very hierarchical, where you have people around the patient bed doing the work, and then you have the leadership group that's actually orchestrating the care, assigning tasks to other people. And it's all very fast-paced, dynamic. And as much as it sounds chaotic, it actually does have a little bit of order in it. These teams do follow established protocols where they're supposed to first focus on major physiological systems, and they even termed it like mnemonic of ABCD, right, where we focus on the airway, breathing, circulation, disability, exposure, which is looking into temperature and some other outside injuries. And then the secondary survey, which is this very detailed head-to-toe evaluation to do and identify anything else that's wrong with the patient. So this is kind of like the setting that I've been focused on. And as I said, it really provided this ideal live laboratory setting for studying a lot of the concepts and regarding coordination of tasks and communication and awareness. So over the past decade, I've done a couple of lots of research in different sites as a PhD student in Jersey, Robert Wood Johnson, which is Adult Trauma Center, and then started collaboration with my closest collaborators that are in Washington, D.C., Pediatric Trauma Center. But then since I started at Drexel, of course, Philadelphia being one of the bigger medical hubs in the country, I also established collaborations with CHOP and then University of Pennsylvania, which is Adult Trauma Center. And early on, my work really focused on understanding the domain and the processes of work. So I looked at various aspects of the teamwork and decision making and errors and coordination and how they use displays in the room and where their attention is and what's the workload of different team members. And even now with my students, we still focus on some of these issues and revisit them in different contexts and with different kinds of questions. But in general, when talking about the epistemological stance, and here I actually borrow some of you know Laisha Palin, and in 2014 she created this really nice visual for HCI and CCW explaining how do we approach research, and I like to use that. So it's really the work we do falls within the interpretivist stands where we really go from the ground up, building knowledge through data-driven, ethnographic, qualitative approaches, and most of the work has been formative, right? Where we go into the field, observe what's going on to inform the design of an intervention or policy or system. And then some of it has been also summative, where we, for example, did a study of effects of a paper checklist on teamwork, or where we introduced the RFID sensors to track people in the room and how that affect teamwork. And then most recently, I also started using research through design, where we do try to generate new knowledge and think about the theory or implications through design actions. Here we mostly use the participatory design, the field practice, where we again work collectively with users, with medical team members, and discuss the design and then again in the wild evaluation and design. So that's been kind of the focus of more recent work that's really focusing on interventions. And so that's part of the talk for today, where I talk about the checklist. So just briefly, I wanted to just talk about like the great people that I've been working in, and mostly my PhD students. And the checklist project today is also driven mostly by Ilya, who is my second year PhD student. And then I also had a couple of students who already graduated. And there's, of course, my medical collaborators, without whom none of this would have been possible. But then also a lot of people over the years I worked with and participated in different projects that have been really great resource and support for a lot of work. And then, as Yunan mentioned, the funding, right, which is again critical, especially in this kind of work that requires so much travel and involvement with the setting and with people. So we've been really fortunate to get some NSF and NIH funding to do this. All right, so out of all these inquiries, right, what really came as a major finding and sort of distilled into insight is that the key problem really is that there are no efficient mechanisms right now in the environment by which information is accrued, synthesized, right, for people to really access and use in their decision making. So what's happening, right, when I told you, you have a lot of people around the patient collecting information, internalizing it, and then externalizing, sharing with the others through reports. People who are doing hands-on exam, or people who are measuring through sensors, right, they're collecting information, reporting it out loud for others to hear and share, and eventually for decision maker to absorb and synthesize and make a decision. The issues are that this information is asynchronous, it's coming at various times. Oftentimes it's also incomplete. People do not always report what they found. They forget, they just get caught up in their work. So there's a lot of back and forth questioning, pull and push going on in terms of asking for information and trying to get. So I call this like from this collective memory where people are keeping information internalized into their own information environments. The idea and where we see technology really has a potential in this kind of environments is in that externalization, right? That we take that information out of their individual memories and externalize it through use of different interventions. And it can be through various kinds of displays that are out there for everybody to see and glance at and look at and get information from. But it can also be through devices that are maybe meant for people who aren't hands-on during the patient care, like the scribe nurse who is there to document and who is eventually using an electronic flow sheet or a system to create a record of what's going on in the room. Or as we are now doing with the checklist, something for the leader to use as a decision support to create to help with the system. So the long-term goal of the research that's the bigger endeavor, not just in my lab, but really through collaboration with the several centers, medical centers, and other universities, is really this long-term goal of developing a smart resuscitation room where we have these ecology of tools and instruments in the room, collecting information, helping, recognizing the context and what's going on, feeding into different systems, instruments, tools, and supporting the work as unobtrusively as possible, which again, right, is a whole set of other challenges. So with my students, I've already done some work on designing a display. We've done a lot of testing in terms of visibility and perception. This is meant to improve situation awareness of not just what's going on with the patient, but also in terms of the process, where the team is, and what's been done. And this is now awaiting the next set of trials to actually go into the environment. And then the project that I wanted to talk about and highlight today is really the checklist that is ongoing now, and we actually have some live trials that I wanted to talk about today. So this is the photo of the paper-based version that was developed in 2012, and at that time it was actually put into the practice in the real world. And it's been used actually for now 5 years. It's one of the first checklists for this environment that was developed and implemented. I will use the rest of the talk really to talk to you about how we use this paper version to develop an adaptive, a semi-adaptive still. It's long from being a very smart adaptive checklist, but how we use this paper version to develop an electronic version. And what were some of the challenges along the way as we were converting it to an electronic format, and then what are we doing right now in the wild evaluation design kind of setting. So just a little bit of background, right? The checklists are very popular in medical settings, and they come from the aviation industry, and designing them actually follows quite closely the paradigm that's been used in aviation industry in designing the checklist. And this is just an example of probably the most famous medical checklist, the WHO, World Health Organization surgical checklist. Because we have this really rich body of work showing how checklists have been effective in improving patient outcomes and reducing errors, the idea is that they could extend to other clinical settings that are error-prone, like safety-critical settings, like trauma resuscitation, that haven't yet used the checklist. And on top of that, what our collaborators observed, not just in their own hospitals, but also other research has shown, that even though we have the protocol the teams follow, there are deviations, there are errors, tasks aren't done all the time. So the checklist was thought of being as a mechanism to actually help people improve protocol compliance and be more timely in completing tasks, which is where the idea for the checklist really came, right? And this is, again, the checklist that I showed you very early on in that setting, that what it actually is. So it follows the protocol I described at the very beginning, but it also has a couple of other sections about what happens before the patient arrives and how to prepare for patient care, a couple of steps, and then that primary and secondary survey where they actually focus on the physiological systems and the injury, and then also the prepare for travel. So it has about 56 items. It's fairly big checklist, but as you can see, everything fits in one page, and it's been used heavily in the real world setting for about 5 years now. But it has limitations, right? And especially for a dynamic environment like emergency room, it's fairly static. You can only do so much on paper and with paper, even though it's great in terms of affordances, but it doesn't really allow that adaptability to different patient scenarios and hectic environment that you're working in. And the literature has also shown that it does, because it's so static and doesn't really, and often has items that are either irrelevant to your case or that are missing because they're not in your case, they aren't really used to the full extent, and they result in poor completion rates and sometimes even provider resistance. And then there's even call for the paradigm shift in terms of how do we design checklists for medicine, because the belief is that the approaches we took from aviation don't really work in the medical environments. So one of the medical experts on checklists has recently called for this shift, and even saying that the continued success of checklists in healthcare requires solving an interaction design problem, which seems like a great problem for HCI, right? And I don't claim to be the one to solve it, but I think that was a really nice motivation for thinking about. And then the second piece is also that digitization of medical and medicine in general, right? So we are seeing less and less paper in medical environments, the introduction of EHR, electronic health record, which is now almost getting to a point of sort of, I cannot really say on a wider note, but I think that we are getting close to actually being fully electronic in hospitals and clinical settings. So eventually, even this paper checklist will go away and will have to be replaced with some sort of electronic version. So the idea with our digital checklist was really to try translate this very basic paper version into a probe, and have a very simple digital checklist that we can put into the environment, and collect data through use in the real world setting, and then elicit design requirements for a real electronic checklist. So the work I'm describing now are really these initial design steps that we are taking towards this adaptive, context-aware, smart checklist for medical emergencies that eventually will emerge out of this. So we started really looking into the paper checklists, and as you can see here, this is one from the real resuscitations, and you see a lot of notes, you see checks and scribbles and unchecks and side notes. So it was really intriguing to us to see that people not only use it as a compliance tool, but there's also a lot of that sort of memory jogger, decision support role to it. And we started looking into a larger set to really understand how is the paper used first. So shortly after the checklist was deployed, literally like maybe a month after in 2012, we took a sample of 163 from actual resuscitations over a 4-month period, and then did a bunch of analysis, both quantitative and qualitative, where we looked at what items are checked or unchecked, left unchecked, what notes people write, the types, categories, and then did some content analysis and open coding to identify those categories. And as you can imagine, right, there are so there are tasks that are almost done always and checked always. So those are the major primary and secondary survey tasks, where the evaluation sort of tasks that people do on each patient. But there were also a lot of optional items that only applied to severe cases, or there were items from the prepare for travel, like the post-care items, or the pre-arrival items that were rarely checked or missed or just simply ignored. A lot of items checked in about 80 to 95% of the cases, and then quite a bit of items that are checked only about 7, 10% of the cases. So that also gave us some insight into like what really should be on the checklist, right? And how do we change the content of the checklist so it meets the needs of the case and the characteristics of the case. When we looked at the notes, 77% of that sample had notes written on it. And then the largest number of notes were for the numerical values for the findings that were easy hard to remember, right? So what was that neurological score, or what were the vitals that we measured? And then least amount of notes were for those non-applicable or if optional kind of items when they had to do more complex cases. And then we also observed three groups of handwritten notes. They were either free form, like any kind of jotting down quickly notes, or numeric, or even numeric with attributes, where they would do a blood pressure, but then they would add over pulp, means it was measured over palpating the patient, not through the instrument in the vital signs monitor. So here are some of the types we observed. Mostly there were patient values, but then there were also some notes about physical findings or symptoms. The pre-hospital information was usually up in the margins of the checklist, like what's the patient name, age, maybe any conditions they know from the pre-arrival information. Also about injury types, location. So there was a large variety of notes that were written on, and the, just to give you some examples, for example, for vital signs, right, they see, they check the box, but then they jot down the value, and even for blood pressure, we often see the repeated measurements were recorded, sort of like trying to get that trend in how the blood pressure changes over time. These were the margin notes where they would put maybe some tests from previous, if it's a transfer case or if it's the if they get information from the ambulance en route to the hospital about the patient, was it loss of consciousness or not, and they're sometimes right there, weight or name even. Lots of notes on the secondary survey findings, locations of injuries, how big are the lacerations or abrasions, even some visuals to pinpoint the location of the injury. And then even for the next steps, they would even put a little checkbox next to it saying, well, look, maybe this is an item that's actually missing and I would like to see it at some point on the checklist. So it was really interesting to see that, right, so much notes were written on it, and it meant that it was important to support that function as we were transferring it into the electronic form as well. And then we also looked at some differences based on the leader experience levels. As I told you, the leaders are mostly hands-off, and they are sort of at the foot of the bed orchestrating the care, assigning tasks and making sure things are running as planned. So they're the ones holding the checklist and doing the whole work. But as we saw, more senior leaders, their notes were more about the values and the findings, so information that's needed for decision making. And then with less senior leaders, who were mostly senior surgical residents compared to attending, surgical attending or physicians, these junior residents would mostly write about completion tasks or the results of the evaluation, which is more like a training tool. So we saw some of these differences that were just initial insights, but not conclusive yet. So what we are doing, we are continuing analysis of paper checklists, especially over the past five years, right? As the practice really took hold and stabilized. So we started another data set in July 2015. And we are still collecting. So as of yesterday, I just looked into our data set. We have about 782 trauma cases, and we were able to collect 584 checklists for those. 40 of those already are digital because we, in the meantime, we started the digital trial. And then we have a bunch of missing for various reasons. Either people don't submit those checklists, or they get lost, or they don't get used. But this time you're also collecting a lot more clinical information. So we can actually look into maybe some of the practices on the checklist use do correlate with the patient case or with the environment characteristics. So we can actually do a more comprehensive analysis. So out of these initial analysis of the paper, the use of the paper, came some of the features that really we thought it was really important and critical to support as we were converting the form into the digital format. First of all, it's now going to be on a mobile device, on a tablet, so it's going to be harder to provide that at-a-glance overview, so we had to think about how our physician's going to navigate the checklist. And while still being able to get that quick overview of the process and tasks. How can we adapt the checklist content so that we minimize the number of unchecks and help really be more efficient in terms of doing the tasks? How do we support the note-taking and recording of the patient values and make it even easier, right? If they're already writing the value, maybe there's no need for that additional click. Maybe we can automatically check for them that task because they're already obviously measuring and writing the value, so it's an indicator that they've done it. And then also for the research purposes, what data do we collect in terms of logging and reporting on the use? So here are the screenshots of the couple screens. So this is the primary survey screens, but I've split it into two because you have to scroll to get through the whole survey. And the optional item is even expanded. So I'm just gonna go quickly over a couple of these features in the interest of time. So to allow that at-a-glance overview, because we opted in for the tabbed design where each section of the paper checklist is moved into a tab, still to be able to give that at-a-glance overview of where am I in the process and how many tasks I still have left over, right? When you have that paper, everything is in one plane, it's easy to see what did I miss. But now with the tab design and items mostly being hidden from you, how do we really allow that? So what we do is tell them under each heading how many items are remaining unchecked, right? And then as they keep progressing and checking, it eventually turns into zero and then a green button like complete. And then we also visually fade off those items that are checked so that only the unchecked items remain black or visible. And again, these are really just some initial design ideas on how we are trying to convert these functions. Another decision was really about those optional checklist items that are taking, right, we're dealing with the limited screen state, right? So on the paper, those optional items are really rarely checked, as we saw in our analysis, because simply there aren't that many difficult cases. They aren't intubating patients that often, or they aren't opening the chest that often. They happen, but they're not so frequent, right? And they're yet taking the space on the checklist and on the screen. So easy fix was really just to make those buttons collapsible or expandable, right, so that they can be pulled on demand in case there are patients that need those procedures, and then we automatically check them by default so that they don't confuse, oh, you still have that one left unchecked. But if there is a need to do that task, then the leader will uncheck and go through the steps. As far as the note-taking, that was maybe the most challenging, and I think it's impacting our digital version a lot, is really trying to allow that effortless, smooth writing that you just take a pen and jot down quickly a few words. How do you really do it on a tablet, right? And hardware is getting better and we have better styluses and screens, but it's still a challenge in terms of recognition. If it's handwriting, do you allow them to type? It's gonna take a lot of time that they don't have and they don't want to use. So again, a quick initial solution was to really provide them with the space to write the note, but then minimize a snapshot of that note for the item for which the note was taken, so it remains there throughout the case so they can see it. And then also the margin notes that we saw often being used for just jotting that pre-hospital information like name and some standard information about a patient that is not specifically related to any of the items in the checklist, we just put that space on the top of the checklist and it stays there even when they move through different tabs. So those are just a couple of features that we went with, and of course we tested this as we were progressing with the design. We went back and forth with the medical experts on our team who were playing with it, looking at it, working. But before we really implemented it, we wanted to do a more thorough feasibility kind of pilot study with that initial design. So five experts on our research team actually did in a shadowing environment. So they used the tablet, but they shadowed the actual leader through real events and used the tablet and did that. And then we were getting feedback from each use about issues and suggestions for improvements or anything that was happening. And we did a couple of changes and tweaks to design based on that feedback, so we automatically resume the checklist if it accidentally gets shut down or closed. We also auto-check items when the handwritten notes are put in. Of course, we allow them to edit and erase notes. And then we also improved a lot of the logging features. So here we are, right? So last October, we felt the design was relatively stable and we could now give it to real users and start a trial. So initially, this is the room where this checklist is now being used. So as you see, I put a big a rectangle around it. So it's put in the back of the room and actually does have a little bit of directions, instructions. We put a lock on it, so it's available 24/7, though it wasn't initially. And we do training with trauma leaders before they start using it. Usually it happens at the orientation time when they come, because these are mostly rotating physicians. So when they come into the hospital, they have orientation to the whole room and the environment. So at that time, we also do training on the checklist, so they get familiarized with the design, with functionalities. And so when the case happens, they walk into the room, they come, take the tablet, turn it on, and start using it. So to date, we have 40 cases, but as I said, initially, they weren't available 24/7 because we really wanted to make sure in the first 3 months there was a research person in the room that could actually troubleshoot in case something happens and help the leaders. So we had 11-day time events initially that we, then it was nice because we were able then to compare to the paper use that was happening overnight or over weekends. But then starting January and through now, we are actually all digital, and they still, of course, have the option to use paper if they want to. But the digital cases, the digital tablet and the form is available 24/7, and to date, we've had 19 daytime and 10 nighttime uses. We also had about 9 trauma team leaders using the checklist to date. We interviewed 5 of them so far. We had 2 fellows and 3 senior surgical residents, so these are all people that are assuming the leadership role. And then we are gathering data through logs. We are also reviewing the videos, something that Yunan have mentioned. We don't have that time crunch restriction anymore, but yes, while I was a PhD student, first time getting into this environment, I literally had to, had only about 48 hours to review a trauma case, and it really required sitting with that video for 48 hours and really getting as much data out of it as possible, because once it was gone, right? But now actually we do have the videos. They are, again, available on a server. We can remotely even log in and watch the case, recorded case, and do these very micro analysis of interaction and what they do and how they use the checklist. Of course, it's the bird view of the situation, so you don't really see what's happening on the screen, but we get that sort of information through the logs. And then we even have the part of the research team in the hospital. They're also doing a larger scale study where they do very detailed video review, where they literally give us the time, start time and end time for each activity. And we can then compare those timestamps to check off timestamps. And we can see when did they check off that task compared to actual task completion and performance. So again, like, even though we have a lot of benefits and affordances in using paper, there are also nice things about a digital format because it allows this really great data to be collected that you could not possibly do with the paper. But anyways, these are just a few examples of the logs. We get timestamps for each check or uncheck, notes that are taken for each item and at what time. We are also doing the tab switching sequence and timestamps. So we're trying to really get as much data as possible out of these logs. So what are some of these, what are some of the initial trends that we observed with the use of the tablet? We have we observed on the go versus at the end checking. So you have junior leaders, again, we have a clear difference here between the experience levels where junior leaders are seeing it more as a training tool and they're very much into do this, have we done it? Yes, 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 right? So it's very on-the-go kind of checking, whereas the senior leader would put it on the side, leave it there, sit, do the work, and then at the very end, come back and pick it up and check it off. And interestingly, it's the same way they use the paper, right? It's not a lot of difference between the tablet and the paper. They do glance frequently at it, though, and the leaders that carry tablet with them, even when they have the touch the patient. They hold it in one hand, and then the other, they touch the patient. So they look at it, and then they glass. So it's not an issue in terms of inhibiting their work and their movement. And again, being the mobile technology, of course, that's one of the main purposes, right? Affording that mobility. But they do have frequent interactions with the tablet, and especially while they're doing the main tasks, and then even then through it, when they're summarizing the process and deciding on the next steps. And what we even heard in some of the interviews that because of the tabbed design, it really helps them focus attention, because I know I'm in the primary, so I should really just be looking into my primary tasks and not worry about the rest. I'll worry about the rest when I'm done with my primary. And then when something goes wrong with the tablet, they switch immediately to paper, and it seems like it's a bummer and they hate it, but then they just, interestingly here, one resident, for example, looks like the tablet crashed at around step D. So she said, I started on iPad, and then starting from step D, she moved on and completed the rest of the checklist on the paper. So we even have these hybrids between the paper and the tablet version. And then, of course, on the video, you can see them like slamming the tablet. Just kidding, but they aren't very happy when that happens. Overall, with note-taking, we see less notes on the checklist, and that's what I said initially. It's really cumbersome to write those notes now on the tablet, and we're really trying to come up with a design solution that will make it easier. But they still take notes. And again, that clear cut between the senior and junior leaders, where the senior leaders would only take notes if there's something really abnormal or specific to the patient. And then most notes are really for the major tasks of the survey. And then when you look at the completion rates, we see fewer omitted items on the digital checklist, and this is still a question, why is that happening? We are trying to really tease more into these. Is it because it's just easier to check them off? I don't know, we are trying to really better understand that. But we see a little bit of delay. There's about an average 3 minutes delay when the item is checked off versus when the task is completed. Or even pre-checks, right? They are starting as tasks, I'm just gonna check it off, even though they're still not completed with that task, but yeah, they started it, eventually they'll complete it. But even the false checks, when officially that task is considered incomplete, based on people who are doing the event logs, the medical experts, and yet we see those tasks checked, but because one component of it was checked, right? And something was done related to it, even though not a complete one. And then there's also a lot of out-of-order checking for a secondary survey task, which is pretty uncommon. And then the tab switching, as I said, we have a capability of following that. And some are really following very, very clean pattern of the pre-arrival and the primary and the vitals, secondary, and prepare for travel. And then you have a bunch that are, this is only based on 14 digital cases for which we had a full data set. And then you have a lot of switching in between tabs. So all of these, right, have some kind of insights and implications for how do we move now towards that adaptive design and what does it really mean for design? So I think some overall design challenges really are, how do we group these checklist items? Do we use the tab design in general, right? How do we arrange them on the form? Do they have to follow the protocol, or do we have some flexibility in terms of grouping them maybe not based on a protocol, but maybe how they are actually done on the front lines at the patient bedside. Because the process is a lot of parallel tasks are happening, and even though they're supposed to be linear, we are seeing they're not. So I think that's one of the design challenges, and especially once we start making it context adaptive, right? How it's gonna really change the content of the checklist. And checklists today are built and designed for a single instance, right? Like there is like a just one first instance of a task, but in a medical environment, there's a lot of repetition and reassessment and periodic monitoring where you actually do a task more than once. So how do we really allow people to track that and be able to let us know that they've done it, or they know that they've done it more than once? And then also the note-taking, I think, as I said, entering values, structured notes, free-form notes, how do we make that more efficient? And there's even been an unintended consequence of the design we did. When we allow them for vitals now, we provide a line to enter the value, and they're like, well, I feel obliged now to put in my vital because you give me the line there, so that means I should put in, but they're not required to do so, right? And then in terms of specific challenges for adaptation, how do we, there's opportunity to adapt that note-taking to the preferences or the needs, but again, right, what are some of the barriers to really making it effortless? The things we are seeing in terms of checking, on the go, at the end, out of order, those are all complicating the idea of adaptation because we are relying on input from the user to tell us, I'm done with A and ready to move on B. But if they are doing it before B or before C or after D, out of order or with a long delay, then how do we give them a timely push into the next task? Or how do we adapt that content on? So do we rely on other sensors in the environment to feed into the checklist? Do we rely on their input? Right? So there's a lot of challenges specific to the context recognition and adaptation. But then finally, unchecked items, here is really an opportunity to have that pull on demand kind of content when the different cases are coming in, or even different trauma activation types, right? A very severe case versus just the transfer. So you can have, they differ, right? In terms of tasks and what they need to do, so you can really have a different checklist for those cases. So just a quick summary, right? So design solutions here are really our initial steps towards designing this dynamic checklist for medical emergency, and I really welcome any feedback or appreciate any suggestions and some discussion. They are feasible, adaptive checklists are feasible, and we are seeing it already in some other calmer medical settings, right, mm-hmm. that aren't that dynamic. But our biggest challenge really is going to be context recognition. And then there's also a lot of design challenges due to conflicting demands of the small space, design space, on the screen size, and then the need to display a lot of things, but also make that transition smooth so we don't affect the care much. So that would be all. Thank you so much for attention, and I really welcome your any questions or comments or anything. So thanks again. Yes.
Hi. Looking ahead a bit, what role do you see for either audio cues or audio input, in particular just grabbing the sound of the thing in case Hello Google can't actually do it, how does that fit in?
Yeah, and it's a great question. We actually, the engineering part of the team actually does look into speech recognition, and some of my students have done analysis of speech where we took the audio and then really analyzed what are the keywords associated with different tasks. And through some keyword spotting, you would actually, there's amazing, there's a finite number of things they do here. I think that's a good news. So it's possible to develop a library or a data set of keywords that are associated, and you know which tasks they relate to use as a cue for bringing up additional content. Or the only challenge, I think, is the noise and the parallel speech, all of the classic challenges in speech recognition. But I think there's definitely some possibility there.
I was thinking not just of using voice input for navigation,
mm-hmm.
but also blind recording the thing so that if it didn't quite get right, a pulse rate of 110, it could be audited later, and particularly with noise-canceling microphones these days, they're just absolutely amazing. Is that something that you're looking at? Or?
Well, the retrospective input, I think it's going to be hard to use because we do want support while the care is happening, right? Mm-hmm. I think it can be done maybe for training purposes, but I think during care, while they're all in the room with the patient, I think we have to rely on their current speech right there in the spot if we are going to use it.
No, I was thinking of the place where you had that numeric entry.
Yes.
And I guess you're thinking that it goes to the cloud where everybody can see it at multiple places as
right.
opposed to being right there. But presumably the audio, I understand, I'm just...
Yeah.
Okay. Thank you.
Let's just touch on that later. Yeah, I'm trying to, I'm not sure I quite understand where you're heading, but
peace.
Yeah, okay, but thank you. Yes.
So I guess I've got one super general question and one super specific question. So the super specific question is, you talked about obviously with an electronic checklist, you're able to measure the out of order completion. Mm-hmm. And I wasn't sure, and I might have missed it, whether your earlier studies of paper checklists had also, I mean, it's hard to know that, but I didn't know if you had like video data or anything.
We tried with some digital pen, like you could do, but it was so hard to get that done.
Yeah, but I mean, it's interesting. It's like this might be a feature of the digital, or it might be something that was already going on.
Mm-hmm.
The super general question is, I mean, you talked about the way that the checklist model is being sort of adopted from aerospace, and there's the famous paper on the checklist in the Apollo program, and one of the things that paper really emphasizes is that the checklist for the Apollo program was not about a sort of like a routine automation, but in fact it was the astronauts themselves who were developing the checklist, and the checklist is sort of this link between people and process that's really about incorporating them in. And so I'm sort of just intrigued as to the context of the checklist here, because it's also an accountability tool rather than an execution tool, and so it would seem that, you know, those kind of, you know, what the drive for the checklist in the aerospace area is as much about allowing people to adjust it as it is about making sure people go through a process. Whereas here it seems to have more of the accountability.
It is, but we also see those appropriations and adjustments, like through that note-taking, or how they care it with themselves and how they use it even post-care. Not as much, but I think there's also a lot of that happening here. But it, in terms of accountability, even like some discussions are now, like, would it be beneficial to project this on the wall so that everybody in the room can see it? And surprisingly, leaders are no, because I don't want anybody else to see my notes. I just want to be able, this is my tool, and don't show it, right? So there's like, so even with that sort of a larger awareness kind of direction to project it for everybody in the room, the question is, what do we project? Maybe just portions of it and leave the private information, right? So it's like public versus private information space questions there. But yeah, I mean, I think there's a lot of that in terms of use and appropriations and interest, like those things transferred from other domains into medicine, and then added on top of it a lot of that accountability and which is...
Yeah, thanks.
Yeah, thank you.
So
yes,
I'm curious to know actually if you are connecting those like digital checklists with any medical devices.
Not yet. The idea is to eventually feed from the so the environment is still very paper based, but they are introducing the electronic health record. Right now everything is happening on paper, but eventually there's going to be an electronic flow sheet that we could connect to the digital checklist, that even the vital signs monitor, right, the sensors in the room, they could all
be connected.
And that's probably one of the easier ways maybe to get that context recognition rather than just rely on the user input, because it's so prone to delays and out of order. It's not as simple though.
It's not
getting all that connected and talking to each other. Yeah. the hand, yes.
In a sense, I want to jump off Paul's comment, because one of the other things that's happening in this context is the education of doctors. And so some of the really interesting data that, at least for me, was looking at the differences between attendings versus residents. So it seems to me that one of the, almost all of these tools are ultimately oriented to improving patient care,
right,
as it should be. But the secondary thing that's happening in that room is improving education.
Yes.
And so it seems to me that's another context that needs to be recognized.
It is.
And that could potentially change what the checklist is doing and therefore how it might be designed.
Exactly. And I think one of the motivations for even introducing the checklist in the environment initially in part was, of course, the compliance with the protocol, but the retention of skills and training, because they do have to go through periodic reaccreditation and training, but this was also seen as a tool that could help. And also, as we are interviewing the junior residents, some of them actually happen to use the digital version first, before paper. And that's also interesting, because it's just like we have this natural random experiment going on, because it just happens that they started their rotation and the checklist is already there. So they're like, oh, well, what's this? How come I just get to go straight into the digital version without even touching the paper first? So, I mean, that's another interesting question that we'll definitely get into exploring.
One short question, which comes a little bit what they're saying too. When you move to the digital, you can't help but realize, I think people experience that as being more public and make their actions more visible than if you're writing something on a paper, piece of paper. Like, as you said, 158 of them got thrown away or lost or something like that. So I wonder if you saw a different orientation to the note-taking by the people themselves. Is it something they could be held accountable to in a new way and that could
definitely
either hinder their honesty or, I mean, cause Paul's getting at the idea that these electronic records oftentimes, you know, necessarily create perfect representations of practice.
Yep, exactly. And we see less note-taking. I mean, I mostly attribute it to just the difficulty, but there's definitely, I think, that kind of awareness of now this is becoming maybe recorded somewhere.
Yeah, who's seeing this? Who's seeing
this?
Show up in court?
So I think there is, and I think like part of our interviews is trying to really tease that also into like how conscious are they of this note-taking practice and what they see, what's the purpose of it, right? And how do they approach? So I think there's a lot of interesting things going on there.
Okay, thanks.
But in terms of who's seeing it, it's really just us for now.
Yeah, I'm just thinking of their mentality.
Yeah, but for them, for them. And I think it's a good point, though. Maybe during the training, we should also be very explicit about this is the data we are collecting and sharing with who and how. The other thing is that, again, you cannot pack everything into 1 hour talk, but as we are getting data from this log, it actually goes through the middleman. So somebody in the hospital first looks at the log, cleans up any patient data. So if there is a name or DOB or something about the patient, it's going to be redacted, wiped out or something, and then it comes to us. So they're even very careful about any, but they don't care so much about what physicians write, right? They are really more sensitive to the
patient.
From a physician's
perspective, it feels very different to scribble on a piece of paper than it is to log something digitally in terms of how permanent and countable.
Exactly.
Thank you.
Sure.
So this actually reminds me some of the work we did with the electronic medical records in the emergency room, right? So especially when you talk about the privacy and private and public part, part of that when I did the observation in the emergency room, and the doctors want to take notes, like what you said, the vital signs or a lot of the information. They wouldn't take notes in the electronic medical record because it's in progress. It's not confirmed. Like I order something, I suspect something would happen, and they would print a page from the computer and they write notes in it.
On it, yeah.
And then they would wait until everything get confirmed, the lab result, everything come back. And they write the perfect notes, and then they save it in the system.
There's also a little bit of that in Melissa and Katie's paper about that perfect record of, right?
Yeah, so it's interesting. I think this is an interesting thing to think about, that the providers also hold kind of part of the notes is their private information.
Yeah,
they would not
exactly.
want other people to see it.
Exactly.
Until they think it's perfect.
Yep.
Yeah.
Yes.
So I think there's a lot of really interesting or similar issues with
mm-hmm.
the EMR design.
Oh yeah.
Yeah.
And I'm even wondering, like, we can't wait for that electronic flow sheet to actually come into play to see how it's that going to be used. And
yeah.
What are some of the effects of that going to be?
Yeah.
Was Mustafa, did you have a
yeah.
question?
So a lot of slides back, there was the paper checklist, and it said in big, bold type, as a reminder when you're looking at this thing, it says, do not put in the medical record.
Mm-hmm.
And you know, paper feels a little bit impermanent, and then electronic feels a little bit like, maybe this could be recorded, but maybe having that, some sort of daily reminder, like, as you're looking at this thing, it says to you, this is not going to be recorded, this is intermediate.
Well, actually it is, because
oh.
they scan it, and then they put it. And either to right, we get it, but it's also part of the chart eventually, right? So, and that's the idea of the digitization to be so because they say don't put it in the medical record so that the hospital staff can take it and then scan it and put it in a secure place.
Mm-hmm.
So they have a little box. They drop their checklists after use, and then we take it. I mean, the hospital take it. And the idea behind the electronic version is, you know, to just get over with the scanning and chasing, right? So that really it feeds right into or from the electronic record. But yeah, I think it also probably has some maybe unintended consequence of how it's treated because it has that big do not put in, not part of the medical record.
Yeah, because it can't be used as like a brain sheet anymore,
mm-hmm.
right?
Mm-hmm.
Like a personal thing.
Yep.
So.
Yes.
I have a question regarding the interface design.
Mm-hmm.
Because so you mentioned your team proposed using the tabs as a
mm-hmm.
navigation. Is that a preferred navigation through the participatory design, or they were given that and they feel like, okay, I like this.
So through some back and forth, that came out to be the most efficient for now, but it's not a final one. I mean, we are still in search for, I guess, that perfect layout. But this was, you know, given some other systems and how they've worked with the electronic health record that's also split into tabs, and so this was probably the most effective at this point to really give as an interface.
My personal interaction with EHR is a lot of the design are mimicking what we're doing in web design. Like we're
mm-hmm.
gonna open a browser and we have different
mm-hmm.
information on different tabs. And that was just translated into everything they program in the software. But
yeah.
There's no innovation in that design itself, and we see it's being adopted over and over.
Yeah.
But when you're in a complicated medical situation, you wanna flip through like surface features and deep features going back and forth. Sometimes you have to drag two screens and compare between tabs.
Yeah.
Right now, I did not see a lot of very dynamic interfaces placed for complicated medical settings that can really satisfy that level of complexity in navigation and being able to really capture both small details and as well as like a bigger picture of like.
It's a big challenge. It is.
Yeah.
All right.
Okay. A lot of really interesting questions, and we do have a social hours downstairs, so make sure you stop by and continue talking to Alex. And just one small note, from next week, I hope I'm still here, but I'm not sure. So we have hosts for each speakers from now on to the end of the quarter. If you're enrolled into 209 class, make sure you attend. You still attend the seminar. We have a sign-in sheet outside. And also submit your assignment online. I will check it remotely. So we have a set of great speakers and making sure you talk to people in your lab and making sure they're coming to the talks. Yeah. Okay.